can't fucking get high.
I saw this movie last week. It's fucking funny.
Quiet, dude.
Hey, Yoda.
Hey, come on, bro.
This isn't the moochin hour.
Dude, you got like 5 bags right there.
Yeah, those are all for me.
Come on, man.
Wait a second, I can't even get high here. And listen, don't wet the tip.
I don't. I smoke it off my fingers.
Whatever, bro. Every time I get it back, it's wet and it's out.
Stop being miserable. Wait, dude, come on, that movie's funny.
Hold on, bro. Brainwashing and scare tactics for the idiots that watch this shit.
Yeah, I heard shots downstairs, but I'm a fucking nobody. I'm just here to support my family.
Yo, what the fuck you talking about, bro? You don't support your family. You're sucking on the government nipple. You're on food stamps.
I can't stand these people, man.
Hey, I just came back from the welfare department.
Fucking losers, bro. Fucking losers. How's the old man?
He's fine. He mentioned Tamar, asked about her.
Christ, that's what I'm saying, bro. Why don't those two just get back together?
You had a hand in that divorce. You told Ma to leave Pop.
Look, bro, I just told her what she wanted to hear, okay? I didn't think she'd leave Pop.
Here, it's out, by the way.
Oh my god, I am so excited. I'm gonna be an extra on a new HBO series. Peter Lollier is directing.
Oh, fuck. Peter Lollier?
Pardon me. Yeah, he's a homo.
Okay, Jesus, dude. Not everybody in Hollywood is a homosexual, okay? He's married, for crying out loud.
He's a Freemason and a sodomite.
Okay, so it's a rite of passage? How do you know all this stuff?
Look, I'm out there working on the midlife build, okay? I talk to people all the time. You know Rocky, my apprentice, who I've known for a long time? Well, he's a third degree Mason. right? Yeah. And he let the cat out of the bag about these bizarre rituals from blindfolding to grown-ass men urinating on each other. And bro, God knows what else is going on. And Robbie has been looking at me weird lately, by the way. Look, bottom line, from Hollywood, the politicians, all the high-ups, bro, they're all Freemasons. But if the mainstream media doesn't tell you, then it doesn't exist.
You are so paranoid.
I'm not, okay? They're all clicked up that way. It's called the gay mafia.
I have no problem being associated with the gay mafia.
All right, well, keep it up, bro. Just watch your ass rubbing up with those fairies, huh?
Anyway, I'm excited to work. You know, be around all those guys. Who knows? Maybe they'll notice me or something.
Fuck. This weed is shit. Are you high?
Yeah.
Must be me.
You're gonna roll another one?
Yeah, I'm not fucking high.
Maybe because you're always angry.
Probably right.
Are you gonna come see me perform?
What the fuck are you talking about?
I told you about this 2 weeks ago. The Fringe Festival. This Saturday?
Look, I can't go, bro. This fucking job? Holy shit, by the time I get back, I'll be exhausted.
You have off the next day. You get that way because you smoke this shit. You know, it makes you unproductive.
Oh, Christ, what else am I gonna do?
I'm gonna go.
Christ, what are you? You're pissed off because I'm not gonna see your show?
Oh man, it's all right. I'm just hungry.
All right. Well, listen, I'll order something. Well, what do you want? You want the magic wok or the brick oven pizza joint?
Magic wok.
Yes, hi. Yeah, I like to order 2 chicken boneless wings with sweet plantains. Yeah. What? It's a $20 minimum now? Okay, throw in a 2-liter Pepsi. Yeah. Yeah, you know who this is, right? Yeah, same address. Thank you. You know, I don't know how these people get into the country. They don't speak a word of English. I guess they get in with 2 simple words, yes and no.
You are such a racist.
Oh, Christ. No, younger brother. I'm just tired of being around all these people, all shapes and colors.
Okay, well, what are you gonna do about it?
Me a racist, okay? First of all, I'm not a racist. Am I prejudiced? Yes, I admit it wholeheartedly, okay? Now, if I act out my prejudice with malice, example, I use a blowtorch on homegirl next to me who plays her Spanish music ceremoniously all night long, then you can classify me as a racist. Second of all, if anyone is racist, brother, it's everybody in this building who's on food stamps. Let me tell you something. You know that anytime it snows, my footprints are the only ones outside the courtyard at 5 o'clock in the morning? If that isn't racist against a working class man who pays bills, I don't know what is. I'm gonna roll another one. You think it's for you? You know, let me tell you something, kid. That TV right there controls everyone's opinions. Man, I don't think anyone has had an original thought in their life. Listen.
I just had an idea for a film. Okay, so it starts off in a supermarket. People are shopping, you know, we cut here and there, and then suddenly we see a man who's not a part of this trance lullaby of shopping. Rather, the man is observing. Okay, so he goes up to a guy at the checkout counter just paying for his groceries, and and he says to him, "Hey, don't pay for that." He says it and he stays with his gaze on this fella.
So I guess he's creeping him out.
No, he opens the guy's eyes, makes him review the notion of, why am I paying for this? I mean, what do people work for, essentially, besides having a place to live?
Putting food in the fridge.
Yes! Agriculture! If everyone grew their own food, you know, tilled their own land, all we need is each other. I mean, what is the ultimate marketing scheme?
What the fuck are you doing, bro? To make people believe that you need things that you don't need.
Bingo, exactly. See that TV right there. It is the ultimate tool fluctuating everyone's perception of reality. This whole mind control structure, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, so back to the film. He moves to the next checkout line and he says the same thing to someone else. And before long, it just becomes this monkey syndrome idea spreading rapidly, and the whole place just goes into this frenzy.
Okay, what's next?
Okay, so the man from the supermarket, he just goes on this whole journey, altering everyone's perception of reality. I mean, people need to know that we have the power. And without our, and I just looked up this word, acquiescence, this whole thing collapses. So before long, he gets up on a checkout counter conveyor and he executes this speech. Because the system has no power. That's a myth. The system has no power. The power that the system appears to have is the power that the public gives to it. We give our power away to a system, which then recycles it back. And at that point, the people think the system has power. But it is our power that's being recycled back.
All right, Geronimo. I'm treading the line. Why would they listen to him?
He's well known. He's an actor or a musician, so you know, so he has credibility.
So they recognize him at the supermarket.
Yes.
Now what?
Okay. He moves from city to city. He dedicates his entire life just going door to door. He becomes like JFK.
Holy shit, bro! JFK was a character on the world stage.
What does that mean?
If I tell you that, your head's going to explode. No pun intended.
Okay, fair enough. But, okay, he's not on television. He refuses to be on any world stage and play into that narrative.
Oh, shit. Okay, so what's the ending? The ending. A civil war of the human psyche breaks out. You know, on one side are his people of perception, and on the other are the ones who refuse to detach from the brainwash. They
can't see any other light besides TV and its programming of their mind. Therefore, after the supermarket scene, we fade to 6 months later, and we see a wasteland of scattered, smashed televisions scattered out. So the man from the supermarket is in hiding. His life is in utmost peril, so he has to get reconstructive surgery on his face. He realizes that his essence must go on, not his frivolous identity. Okay, afterward, he infiltrates the opposition's network through a turncoat. Along with the turncoat, they reprogram people's minds with subliminal messages to his ideology of un-TV-topia. This movie, it's a happy ending. And it'll mock the masses like every other Hollywood film. I could probably pitch it to Peter Lohier on set. Oh my God, catch him at lunch! He actually eats with the crew.
Good luck with that.
Okay, yeah, I'm gonna go.
Wait, what about the food?
No, man, I lost my appetite.
Oh, Christ, you're too sensitive, dude.
It's my vocation to be sensitive.
Well, it's been 3 weeks. I thought you were holding a grudge or something.
Ah, nah, bro, that's something you do. I've been busy.
Oh, okay. Wait, bro. You want to smoke, man? Cause what?
No. I'm good. I'm good.
Alright, what's going on, man?
What? Am I throwing you off?
No, it's more annoying, actually.
Well, guess what?
I hate that, bro.
No, it's a good question. I gotta reel you in.
Okay, what?
Remember that film?
Yeah, the guy at the supermarket.
I pitched it to Peter Lohier.
The homo?
Are you gonna tell him that when he's here?
What the fuck are you talking about?
No, Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Yes, bro, he's gonna be here in 15 minutes.
Wait, are you fucking for real? Are you fucking with me?
I'm not fucking with you. He's gonna be here in 15 minutes. He wants us to sell him the script. Oh my God,
shut up. Fucking kidding me, bro.
I am so excited. Oh, fuck. I sat right next to him and I introduced myself. He was like, I know who you are. You're one of those students in that biology class scene. And I said, that's right, Pete. And then he said, I'm Lucas. I don't mean to take up your time, but I have this idea for a film. And he said, oh, really? Let's hear it. And I said, okay. A guy walks into a supermarket, and then he stopped me short and said, why don't you invite me over to your residence tonight and pitch it to me there? Pete was completely transfixed. He couldn't take his eyes off of me. It's not like that at all.
Yeah, well, I don't know, my boy. Well, what does he want specifically?
Okay, I told you, he wants us to pinch the... I don't know.
What the hell? What do you mean you don't know? You got this guy coming here uninvited on my account.
Okay, well, I'm definitely not bringing him over to Ma's house. Look, he wants us to sell the idea to him.
Then what?
I don't know. I don't know how this works.
Yeah, I do, and I'm not sucking no dick.
You're kidding.
Yo, couldn't you write him a premise? He doesn't have to come here.
Okay, maybe he's a hands-on kind of guy.
Well, you're the one throwing you in your windows.
Okay, look, we have to focus. He is coming here, so we need to devise a plan.
Oh, Christ. Okay, I'm gonna play him. All right, prepare you.
What are you gonna do when he's here?
I'm gonna sit in this chair and be your yes man.
Oh God, I'm really nervous now.
Yeah, you know, smoke, it helps, bro.
Who is it?
It's me, Pita LaPierre.
He doesn't have a French accent.
Aw, you're gonna have to roll me, kid.
Okay, fine.
Oh, what a wonderful flat you have.
Now he's using British terms with a French accent?
Oh, wait, what do you want, method acting? We don't have time.
Okay, let's run through it.
Oh, who's that fellow over there?
That's my brother, Tony.
Ooh, what a handsome man. I can see the apples don't fall far from the tree, huh?
Okay, sure, Pete.
Okay, so listen, I think you'll love this.
Your films, they speak highly of renegades, of rebellion.
The film, yes, of course, the man in the supermarket.
Yes, he's a pioneer.
Yes, pioneer, I love your language.
Okay.
So what's the opening?
Okay, so we start off in a supermarket. People are shopping, we cut here and there, and then suddenly we see a man who's not a part of this shopping, consuming, etc. Rather, the man is observing.
How unusual.
So, he goes up to a guy at the checkout counter just paying for his groceries, and he says to him, hey, don't pay for that. He says it and stays with his gaze on this fellow.
Yes, and then that fellow falls in love with his gaze.
Oh, yeah, no.
Listen, I like to get right into things, okay? No foreplay.
Okay, let me finish, Mr. Lovely here.
Okay, continue.
All right, returning to the film. He moves to the next checkout line, and he says the same thing to someone else. And before long, it becomes this monkey syndrome idea, and all of a sudden, an epiphany of hysteria takes place.
Yes, in other words, diabolical debauchery.
Mr. Lohier, please, all due respect.
Lucas, what did you expect, huh? I am part of the gay mafia.
Oh, my God. So what's the plan?
What's the plan?
The plan.
The plan is, you talk, he listens, and I nod my head.
Fine.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, God, I am so stoned. Whose stuff is this?
It's Hay Heads.
Jesus, I can't even move.
Yeah, I know, man.
Yeah, it was hitting me too. Hitting me really good. Have you talked to Joe lately?
No, why?
Oh, no, I just thought of him now. Remember the first time we smoked, I kept having those paranoid thoughts that someone was gonna come here and hurt him.
Remember?
Yeah, I remember.
So you haven't talked to him?
No, Lucas. I made the effort, he doesn't respond. I'm not gonna chase anybody.
Maybe we should do something. You wanna play rock band?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh man, I can't snap out of this funk.
May the heavens roar that way this woman hears this shit. Got the new speakers.
You got new speakers, yeah? You got new.
That sounds good, that sounds good.
Yes, Peter, we apologize.
Lucas, are you kidding me? You gonna light those up right in front of me?
Ha ha ha!
just don't wet the tip, huh?
What? What?
The tip wasn't wet when you gave it to me. I always expect a wet tip from getting it back. It's a sign of camaraderie. Intimacy amongst men bonding over a joint.
Oh.
The tip having no indication of moisture, I felt icicles down my spine just seconds ago.
You're from Los Angeles, right, Pete?
That's right. My buddies and I smoked in the inner city playground in the dark. We were idiots back then. We smoked weed, Billy Blunts, later White Owls. Those things were always drenched in damp. And again, when you think about it, what phallic object doesn't have a wet tip, right? Oh, excuse me, how rude. You must be Tony, because Lucas said we'd be meeting at his brother Tony's place, right?
No, that's okay. We don't need to shake hands.
Yeah, Pete. He's a bit of a germaphobe.
That explains the unwet tip.
So, Los Angeles, where does the lowly air come from? It's French, right?
Right again. My father's origins are from France. My mother, on the other hand, is from the Lombardy region of Italy.
That's cool, Pete.
I appreciate that. Just don't ask me to speak French. Although I do speak some Italian. Fortunately, I didn't inherit my mother's maiden name. Otherwise, people would think I'm in some sort of mafia or something. Oh. You get smoke in your eye, Tony? Crack that window open a little bit.
I'm okay.
So, what do you do, Tony?
I work in construction.
What project you working on?
Over there in the MetLife building.
Some restorations, I assume.
Yeah.
When was that building erected?
Excuse me?
Erected. Constructed, aren't those the terms?
It's the weed, Peter. We got it from Hayhead.
Yeah, I don't know who that is, but this stuff is obviously lethal to your brother. Hayhead. Yeah, we had some pretty interesting nicknames for our drug dealers in LA too.
Yeah, his his hair is like horse hay. It's Hayhead.
1959.
Coherent response.
I said, excuse me, because the word erected doesn't necessarily mean completion of building. Erected and constructed are somewhat similar, however not tantamount. The building was topped off in 1962, then completed in 1963, and not to mention it was formerly known as the Pan Am Building.
Bravo. I love to know this kind of stuff. You know, I have a huge respect for masons like yourself.
Pardon?
Are we gonna play this game again? You're a builder, Tony, a mason. That's what masons do, they build. I can't stay long because I have to get back. I have to go over dailies, reschedule scenes, the weather, location, etc. I think your scenes are done. You're no slouch. I'm gonna make sure you're well featured in the biology class scene for the main character. I take notice in the background. You're the most believable student in the scene.
Thank you so much.
So, I'm excited to hear about this film you've concocted.
Oh, yeah, man, the film. I don't even know where to begin.
What What's the opening?
But yeah, of course, the opening. I am so sorry.
supermarket.
Yes, of course.
Why don't you role play in
front of me? Tony?
Yeah, I don't see why not. Okay, so it starts off in a supermarket. People are under a trance lullaby of shock. We cut here and there, and then suddenly we see a man who's not a part of the shopping. Rather, this man is observing. He is studying these humanoids in a trance.
I have to say, I am already locked in. The whole opening of a herd construct, the cuts alone illustrate a docile society with no sense of self. Fantastic, Lucas. Please, continue.
Thank you so much. Okay, so the man who is observing, he goes up to a guy at the checkout counter just paying for his groceries, and he says to him, "Hey, don't pay for that." He says it and he stays with his gaze on this fella.
Of course. Of course he stays with his gaze. Because he's trying to snap him out of it. I am a big fan of characters shifting out of illusory realities. Take, for example, the film I'm working on, which you're familiar with, Lucas. The main character goes from college life to incarceration. One pivotal scene shifts his reality. You guessed it, getting fucked in the ass.
Miss Lillier, get out of my house.
Bro, what?
Wow. What lovely music. You live on a third floor of salsa music. The flight below was hip hop. And on the first floor, I believe I heard Mozart.
There ain't no Mozart on the first floor.
You choose to hear what you think you hear.
Listen, pal, I know all about your ways, okay? The Freemasons, hidden in plain sight. I'm hip to the ground you're plowing. Did you see what I did there, Pete?
Whether you're right or wrong, quite frankly, I came here to hear Lucas's film. And if your radar was turned up, you know he's onto something. Something good. Something ahead of its time. I could have opened that door for him. Instead, I'm going to open that door. And I'm going to walk out.
It's open. How'd you get in?
Spanish woman next door. Let me in.
Oh.
So at least that woman can do.
How's the old man?
Fine.
Good. How's mom doing?
Fine.
Good.
I'm good.
Hey man, yo, I'm home, yo. This is my favorite part. When the guy goes to the liquor store and robs the joint.
Ask me about Lolia.
Pow.
Yeah, you think this is funny?
Oh, Christ, bro. I'm stoned, all right? I'm sorry.
Tell me you love me. Tell me you love me. Tell me you love me. Tell me you love me.
Yo, bro, come on, man.
Tell me you love me.
Yo, bro, you're freaking
Tell
me out.
Tell me
bro,
you love
you're freaking
me.
Freaking me out. What are you doing?
Tell me you love
bro,
me.
Bro, what are you doing?
Tell me you love
Yo,
me.
Bro, listen.
Tell me you love
no,
me.
No, bro. I don't know what you've been learning at your fucking little acting conservatory.
Okay, this isn't about that.
Yeah, whatever, bro. It's like you got this new outlook on life, right? You think you're better than me.
You can't even tell me that you love me.
Oh, Christ, bro. I don't need to say any of that shit.
I can't come here anymore.
Then don't. Doing things with your life. What the fuck am I doing? I'm stuck. I don't want to hear about your aspirations, your fucking dreams, right? What the fuck am I doing? I have nothing. I do nothing. I have a son who resents me, a shitty fucking apartment. Yeah. You're not going anywhere, you fucking little shit. Get it in my face. Fucking kid. You're like I need to knock you out. Fucking kid, I ruined my eye. You don't have to come here anymore, alright? That's okay, because I'm not the best influence for you. In some ways, I wanted you around so I could harm you. Take away the ambitions you have that I can never build, the courage and strength to own.
My life has been one routine that I'm content with, and when you're around, you give me hope, and then it dissipates. That idea for that film was genius, man, and I sabotaged the whole thing. Look how far you went. You got a well-known, brilliant director to come over to my shitty apartment. What does that say, brother? Don't let me or anybody barricade the path you aspire towards. I'm miserably bored. I have a lot of shame. I have a son who resents me. Because I'm a coward. Stay in touch.